all take our hymn books together this morning and join me in standing. Page number 11 in your hymn books, page number 11, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. Let's sing that together. A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. For still in amidst the flood of mortal ills prevailing, for still our ancient foe does seek to work us woe. Continue singing, page 255. What a wonderful Savior. Let's sing just the first and last verse together.
Christ has for sin atonement made. What a wonderful Savior. We are redeemed, the price is paid. What a wonderful Savior. What a wonderful Jesus, what a wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord. He walks beside me in the way, what a wonderful Savior, and keeps me faithful day by day, what a wonderful Savior, what a wonderful Savior.
God's people said?
Amen.
Amen. Well, we're glad to have you here with us today. I have a number of folks visiting with us this morning. The Lord has been good to us this week. Amen. I know that many of you have been praying about my wife, and she went to the doctor up in Tampa at Moffitt this week, and they examined her eyes. She's had cancer in her eyes, and her eyes are all clear. Thank you for your prayers. By the prayers of God's people, and her vision is coming back. She's been getting chemo injections in her left eye. It's diminished her vision there, but they said that her vision has improved by three lines. That's the lines that you read, and so we praise the Lord. Her vision is coming back. Thank you for praying, and the Lord is so good to us. Amen. Then I gave you the good news, on top of good news, of our daughter, Darcy, and her husband out there in California. He's been a captain in the Army, he was sent over to Afghanistan, and they were just waiting after he came back and got out of the Army. He last year, he handed in his resignation, and they didn't want him to leave, so he still has a bit of time to go before he's completely out. They were waiting till he got out of the Army before they had a baby, and we got the good news this week, also on Wednesday, same very same day, that she is going to have a baby. Amen. So we're happy about that, and that'll be her first baby. The only bad thing is they're in California. That is the worst thing right there. But we're praying, you know.
There's airplanes.
Yeah, there are airplanes. I just don't like to fly in them, but there are airplanes.
You're going to.
Praise the Lord. We've had some people saved around here this week. We've had several saved here at our church. And Brother Tony, you want to come up here and lead us in prayer, brother? Why don't you come right up here and lead us in prayer? He's been leading the whole effort over there at the fair this week and helping to win people to the Lord. And we just were glad for him and his faithfulness to the Lord. And I have a little gift I'm going to give to him this morning, but why don't you lead us in prayer? Tell us how many people have been saved over there, brother. This is for you. We appreciate you, brother. God bless you. Amen.
Amen. It's been, during the week it was pretty slow, and, different fairs have different aspects as far as activity goes and how many people show up, but it still has been good. This week was kind of strange because of the fair itself, the fair people. There was three things that took place where they came back and told me what we could not do. Really never had that happen in that much, but that's okay. God is still on the throne. Yeah. 43 people made a profession of faith.
Amen.
So I just praise the Lord for that opportunity. This is the last day, so just pray for this last day. Got a couple of friends here from up in that neck of the woods who came down faithfully for the weekends. I just thank you for the help that people came out to help us. It just takes a load off, and just thank the Lord right now. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we do thank you for this day. We thank you for this church. Be with the service, be with the preaching, everything that's done and said. God, we just love you now. We just thank you for what you're going to do. If there's someone in here today that does not know you, by faith they would come, realizing a lost because of sin that separates us from God, because Jesus Christ came into this world, who died on a cross, was buried and rose again, to come to you by faith that they can be saved and born again by putting their faith and trust in you and you alone. We thank you now for what you're going to do in this service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
May be seated. Let me ask this morning. Maybe you're visiting here with us today. This is your first time with us at Liberty Baptist Church. You're a welcome guest. We're glad to have you here. And if one of the ushers did not give you a packet of information about our church, if you did not receive one of those packets, just slip your hand up. If you're here for the first time at Liberty Baptist, you did not receive one of those blue packets. It's got information about our church in it. Would you slip your hand up? Hold it there for just a minute. Keep it up for just a minute. And our ushers will put one in your hand. Let me tell you, it's important that you get one of those because there's a card in there. If you'll fill that card out and take it to the welcome desk out in the foyer, then they have a book for you. It's called the Bible Promise Book. It's got promises from the Word of God. And so you fill that card out, take that, give that to the person there at the welcome desk at the end of the service, and they'll give you one of these books. These are great books. I have one. I carry one myself when I'm out visiting. And so let me encourage you, fill that card out, give it to them right after the service. The choir's going to sing for us.
Let's all stand together. We're going to sing our chorus this morning. He's able, he's able. I know he's able. Let's sing that together one time and then we'll greet one another this morning.
He's able, he's able. I know he is able. I know my Lord is able to carry me through. He's able, he's able.
Through. down to you. Books with me one last time. 146, Jesus paid it all. Sing the first and second and last verse together. Jesus paid it all.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small, child of weak, find in me thine all in all.
Singing, you may be seated.
Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. You are the one that we pray. Always hunger for, oh, our hearts always hunger for. Counselor, comforter, keeper, spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when your hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty, infinite Father, faithfully loving your own. Here in our weakness you find us, falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and strength our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Man. Take your Bible, turn with me to Psalm 17. Psalm 17. When you found your place there, if you can stand with me, go ahead and stand. Psalm 17. I'll begin reading with verse 1. Hear the right, O Lord, attend unto my cry, give ear unto my prayer that goeth not out of feigned lips. Let my sentence come forth from thy presence. Let thine eyes behold the things that are equal. Thou hast proved mine heart. Thou hast visited me in the night. Thou hast tried me and shalt find nothing. I am purposed that my mouth shall not transgress. Concerning the works of men, by the word of thy lips I have kept me from the path of the destroyer. Hold up my goings in thy paths, that my footsteps slip not. I have called upon thee, for thou wilt hear me. O God, incline thine ear unto me, and hear my speech. Show thy marvelous loving kindness, O thou that savest by thy right hand them that put their trust in thee, from those that rise up against them. Keep me as the apple of the eye. Hide me under the shadow of thy wings. From the wicked that oppress me, from my deadly enemies who compass me about, they are enclosed in their own fat. With their mouth they speak proudly. They have now compassed us in our steps. They have set their eyes bowing down to the earth, like as a lion that is greedy of his prey, and as it were a young lion lurking in secret places. Arise, O Lord, disappoint him. Cast him down, deliver my soul from the wicked, which is thy sword, from men which are thy hand, O Lord, from men of the world, which have their portion in this life, and whose belly thou fillest with thy hid treasure. They are full of children, and leave the rest of their substance to their babes. As for me, I will behold thy face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake with thy likeness. I've entitled the message, Why Me? Why me? It's a question that we ask. Why me? David asked that question here. He's praying to the Lord, and he asked the question, why me? And we find the answer, why me, in this passage, and I think that it can be a help to us. We've all said that at one time, why me? Something happens, and we go, why me? Sometimes we just whisper it to ourselves. Sometimes we'll even say it out loud. Why is this happening to me? Why me? Well, we can find out here in this passage. We can get some solace. We get some help from the Lord. David knew where to go. You know, he knew where to go. He went to the Lord in prayer. We can find that out from this passage. And I hope that it'll be a help to you today. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Dear Lord, meet with us this morning. Many of us have had some of those why me moments even this week. Dear Lord, I pray that you'll teach us from the psalmist how to deal with those things, and that we can trust in you, and we know that when we trust in you and we rely upon you, you can take us through those things. We may not understand it all right now, but one day we will, and you'll give us the grace to help us in our time of need even now. Dear Lord, I pray if there's one here that needs Christ as their Savior, that you would save them this morning. That's what they need more than anything else. Now bless the preaching of your word, and I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Pastor and his family moved to a new town, a new church, and they were busy unpacking, and they were so busy unpacking all of their boxes that they forgot about their little dog. And it was getting late at night, and they forgot all about their little dog. Their little dog's name was, get this name, Trouble. I thought, that's a neat name, Trouble. Well, it was getting late, and the pastor's wife decided that they had better take that dog for a walk. And so she was already in her pajamas, and she just thought, well, it's so dark out and so late, nobody's going to see me anyway. And so she put her robe on and put the leash on their dog, Trouble, and she went out on the front to take the dog for a walk. And as she's walking down the sidewalk, the dog, this was all new to that dog. And so that dog just took off running, and the leash came right out of the pastor's wife's hand, and that dog went running down the sidewalk. And she thought, well, this is a strange neighborhood, and I better go after that dog. And so she went running after the dog. She's running down the sidewalk as fast as she can to try to catch that dog. And all of a sudden, a squad car pulls up next to her. Policeman rolls the window down, and he said, ma'am, can I help you? She said, no, thank you. I'm just looking for trouble. Did you ever ask that question, why me? Why me? David asked the question in this passage, why me? He knew where to go. He knew exactly what to do. He went to the Lord in prayer, and he knew that God would deliver him. And he knew that he was living for God, and he was faithful, and that God would answer his prayer. And Peter calls this suffering for righteousness' sake. And God allows us sometimes to go through these things. We're not doing anything wrong. We're living righteously. We're being faithful to God. And sometimes when we're doing all those things, we're faithful to God. We're serving God. We're going to church. We're reading our Bible. We're praying. We're witnessing. We're doing all the right things, and something happens. You know what? And we go, man, I'm doing everything right. Why me? Why me? Well, David was doing everything right. And he asked the question, why me? I remember as a boy, most of the time I was a pretty good little boy. I didn't get in too much trouble, but my brother Doug, he was really mischievous. He was just here with us a few weeks ago, and now that he's gone, I can talk about him. But sometimes he would do things and get both of us in trouble. I didn't do anything. I'm telling you, I didn't do anything. And I would get in trouble along with him. And I would say, I didn't do anything. It's his fault. I didn't do anything. And they wouldn't care. They wouldn't listen to me. And I would be disciplined, and I'd be sent up to my room. And I remember as a little boy going up there saying, I didn't do anything. Why me? Why me? I didn't do anything. Why me? It's all his fault. I didn't do anything. David is saying, why me? He hadn't done anything. He was doing right. And yet we know that King Saul was coming after him, and he was trying to take his life. It wasn't just coming after him, but he was trying to take his life. He wanted to kill him. David said, why me? All of this trouble. Why me? Anyway, if we look at this passage of Scripture, and we'll see four different petitions that he offers unto the Lord in prayer, and he's asking that question, why me? First of all, the first petition there, verses 1 through 4, we see he says, why me? Hear me. Hear me. Look at verse number 1, verses 1 through 4. He says, hear the right, O Lord, attend unto my cry, give ear unto my prayer that goeth not out of feigned lips. Let thy sentence come forth from thy presence. Let thine eyes behold the things that are equal. Thou hast proved mine heart. Thou hast visited me in the night. Thou hast tried me and shalt find nothing. I am purposed that my mouth shall not transgress concerning the works of men. By the word of thy lips I have kept me from the paths of the destroyer. He's saying, Lord, I've not done anything. I'm innocent. You see that? I've not done anything. You've tried me and you found nothing, Lord. He said, hear me. Hear my prayer. Nothing is coming out of my mouth. I've not transgressed out of my mouth. I'm innocent. I'm faithful. I'm righteous. Why is this happening? Hear me, O Lord. Deliver me from my trouble. That's what his prayer is. He knew that God had examined him and found nothing. David is not saying that he's sinlessly perfect here. There's not any of us that are sinlessly perfect, but he was right with God. All we have to do is confess our sins to him, amen, and we can be right with God. Why? I've often wondered to myself, why not be right with God, amen? Why not just get right with God? Yet we put it off. We want our prayers to be answered. David wasn't being a hypocrite. He knew that he could have his prayers answered. Here's a psalm for you, Psalm 66 and verse 18. The Bible says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. We need to make sure we're right with God. Amen? When our prayers answered, David is saying, listen, I've not done anything. I'm right with you. That there are some that want the best of both worlds. They think that they can go to the Lord when their lives are not the way they should be. When our lives are right with the Lord, we don't have anything to be ashamed. We have no reason not to come to the Lord, and we ought to come to the Lord. The story of the little boy that stole money from his parents. He took that money and pocketed that money. And then he went to his parents and he asked them if they wouldn't take him to the toy store. Now they knew that he took the money. Are they going to take him to the toy store? No, they're not going to take him to the toy store. Because they knew where he got the money from. Here's a boy that stole and he lied to his parents. Are they going to take him? No. Listen, folks, we need to make sure we're right with the Lord. Amen? We need to make sure that our hearts are right with God. Little boy's version of an Old Testament verse. A lie is an abomination unto the Lord and a very present help in the time of trouble. Do you know what? We need to get it right with the Lord. David, first of all, says, hear me. He says, why me? First of all, he says, hear me, I'm innocent. Then secondly, he says, keep me. Look at verses 5 and 6. Hold up my goings in thy paths, that my footsteps slip not. I have called upon thee, for thou wilt hear me, O God. Incline thine ear unto me, hear my speech. And then in verse number 8, keep me as the apple of the eye. Hide me under the shadow of thy wings. He said, keep me. Keep me in thy paths. His petition is, first of all, hear me. Listen, I'm innocent. I'm living righteously. There's no guile coming out of my mouth. I'm right with you. But then he says, keep me. Now keep me from the paths of unrighteousness. You know, we all need to pray that prayer. Amen. We need the Lord's help. You can't do it on your own. Amen. We need God's help. God can help us. We can go to Him, and He will help us. We can't do it on our own. David, a man after God's own heart, he knew that he couldn't do it on his own. And so he's asking the Lord for help. Keep me from the path of unrighteousness. Help me. Boy, every morning we need to pray that prayer. Amen. Every day we need to spend time with the Lord, asking God to help us in that day. Help us. We'll stay in God's will, then God's blessing will be upon us, and we need God's blessing. One day, this is years ago, after church on a Sunday, we're driving down McIntosh Road. We live off McIntosh Road. We're driving down McIntosh Road, and there's a big turtle, and that big turtle is walking right down the middle of the road, right down the white line, right down the middle of the road. There weren't any cars behind us, and so I slowed up. I said, children, look at that. Look at that turtle. And they're saying, oh, daddy, that poor little turtle, that poor little turtle. I said, well, that turtle will be okay as long as it keeps walking right down that line. I said, but if it gets on either side, it's going to be turtle soup. You know what? We need to go down the line. Amen? We need to stay right on the line. Stay right on the line. And we need the Lord's help to do that, don't we? We need the Lord's help to walk down that line. Because we can't do it on our own. And that was David's prayer. We get off that path. My friend, we end up in a mess, don't we? Amen. We end up in a mess every time. We need to listen to God's word. Listen to what God has to say. A fellow was driving down a country road. And all of a sudden, the car just stopped. And he glided to a stop there on the side of the road. And he flipped the hood, went out, and began looking under the hood to see if something was loose, or to see if there was something he could fix. And so he's looking under there, and as he's looking under the hood, there's a horse that comes galloping in the field next to him. This horse comes galloping by, and the horse slows down, looks over at the man, and says, "You need to check your fuel." And then the horse just rides on, goes on. And he goes, "Wow." He saw a farmhouse right there, and he walked over to the farmhouse, and he knocked on the door. A farmer came to the door, and he said, "Sir," he said, "man alive, I just can't believe. You just won't believe what just happened to me." And the farmer said, "What?" He said, "Well," he said, "my car stalled out, and I pulled it off the side of the road there." And he said, "I flipped the hood, and I was looking under the hood," and he said, "all of a sudden, this horse come galloping by in the field right next to me. And he slowed down and looked over at me. He said, 'You need to check your fuel.' And then he just rode on, galloped on." The farmer said, "Wow." He said, "Was it a white horse?" He said, "Yes." He said, "Did it have a bent over ear?" He said, "Yes." He said, "Well, don't listen to him. He doesn't know one thing about cars." Now you're waiting to hear what I'm going to say, I know. We shouldn't be listening to any horse, but we can listen to God, amen? We need to listen to the Lord. David listened to the Lord. God would give him help. David said, "Why me? Man, I'm doing everything right. Why me? Hear me. Keep me." Then he says, "Show me." Look at verses 7 and to verse 12. He said, "Show me. Show thy marvelous loving kindness, O thou that savest by thy right hand them that put their trust in thee from those that rise up against them. Keep me as the apple of the eye. Hide me under the shadow of thy wings from the wicked that oppress me, from my deadly enemies who compass me about. They are enclosed in their own fat. With their mouth they speak proudly. They have now compassed us in our steps. They have set their eyes bowing down to the earth, like as a lion that is greedy of his prey, and as it were a young lion lurking in secret places. He said, show me. Show thy marvelous loving kindness. Show me thy loving kindness. You see that phrase, loving kindness, that word, loving kindness? You know what that is? That's mercy. Loving kindness is the definition of mercy. Amen? Mercy is loving kindness. God shows us his mercy. God gives us his mercy all the time. Aren't you glad for the mercy of God? Amen? God gives us what we don't deserve. Well, you ought to be thankful that God didn't give you everything you deserve. Amen? We ought to be lifting the roof off this place, praising God that God is a merciful God. I thank God for his mercy every day. Because God gives me what I don't deserve. Man, what a great week God gave to us this week. Man, I didn't even need a car to drive up to Tampa. I could have flown up there, you know it? Flown up there, up, on the way up. That's when my daughter Darcy called us and told us that she's going to have a baby. And on the way back, that's when we knew that my wife didn't have cancer in her eyes. Amen. I could have flown up and flown back without a car. God's a God of mercy. Amen. Thank God for his mercy. Sometimes people come to me and they say, will you pray with me, preacher? I've got some trouble. There's some difficulties and so forth. You know what? I'll say, I'll pray with you. We'll pray for the mercy of God. Amen. Sometimes that's all we can call upon is the mercy of God. Amen. Because we know we've not done everything right. But God is a merciful God. Thank God for his mercy. David is saying, show me your mercy, dear God. Protect me. You know, when we pray for the protection of the Lord, that doesn't always mean that he doesn't allow us to suffer. Amen. Sometimes God allows us to go through troubles. Sometimes God allows us to suffer. Sometimes God allows for those difficult things to come into our life. God's got a greater purpose, and God can help us through the pain. He'll protect us when we're going through the circumstances. We can't understand it. We say, why? But you know what? God understands why, and God can take us through, and God can guide us through. God will help us get through it. Amen? Thank him for his mercy. He's a merciful God. About 25 years ago, in the morning, I was reading the paper, Sarasota Tribune. I was reading the paper. I was on the local page of the newspaper. And this, there was a news article. It was in bold print. And it said, Macintosh Road to be straightened. And I read that and I said, that's interesting. Macintosh Road, this is Macintosh Road out here, to be straightened. I thought, that's interesting. They're going to straighten the road out. And I began to read the article about how they're going to straighten the road, and it told about how there's a developer that owned property on the north side of Bella Vista. And that developer, who was an English fellow, he had worked out a deal with the county. And for a large sum of money, he sold the property so they could extend Macintosh Road. It was kind of a deal that they had worked out, and he made a large amount of money. He was supposed to develop all that and build houses over there, and they have built some houses over there. But they were going to build lots of houses over there. And how he had negotiated this deal with the county. And I thought, that's interesting. They're going to straighten Macintosh Road out. They've sold this property to this guy sold his property to the county. They've got the property. And I'm thinking to myself, how are they going to straighten that road out anyway? Because this road, some of you know, this Macintosh Road used to come to Bella Vista, and then you would go up about 100 yards, maybe about 100 yards, and then you would turn and go Macintosh Road extended back down that way. And so I thought, this is interesting. And I'm thinking to myself, well, Our church is right in the way of that. And so I called the church attorney and I said, listen, did you read the paper today? And he said, yes. I said, did you read the story about the straightening of McIntosh Road? He said, yes. I said, get it out and read it again. I said, you know, our church is right there at the corner of McIntosh and Bella Vista, and that's where our church entranceway is. He said, yes, because he had been here. Robert Henshaw was our lawyer at that time. And I said, you want to find out about this? And he said, yes. He said, Reverend Jackson, I'll call you back. And he called me back within an hour, and he said, well, you're not going to want to hear what I'm going to tell you. I said, what are you going to tell me? He said, well, they've worked a deal out. The county's worked a deal out with that guy, and they're going to take your property by eminent domain. I said, they're going to take our property. He said, yeah, they're going to build that road right through your church property. He said, they worked it out. They bought that property behind you so they could do this, so they could get your property. He said, that's the way they did it. He said, that's the way they operate here. He said, the first thing they're going to do, somebody from the county will come over there and bring a paper and want you to sign that paper and sign that property over to Sarasota County. I said, no way. He said, a way. That's what they're going to do. They're going to want you to give that property. I said, this is the Lord's property. I'm not going to give it to Sarasota County. He said, well, you'll just tell them that when they come. He said, they'll be coming. And he said, then they're going to take your property by eminent domain, and they can do that because they've already owned the property behind you. That's the reason they negotiated that deal. And so they'll take your property. And I said, well, we'll have to fight it because I'm not going to give them the property. And he said, well, we'll start working on it right now. And sure enough, it wasn't long before there was a knock came on the church door, and there was a official from the county, and they brought a paper into my office, and they said, here, we want to ask you if you'd donate this property. He said, take your paper and take your car and get off the church property right now. That was my answer to them. I'm not going to give the Lord's property to anybody, you know what? So they left. And they came and served us with the papers to take our property by eminent domain. And we went to court. And when we went to court, the county lawyers were there, and the county people were there, and we were there with our lawyer. And they began to read what they were going to do. They said they were taking vacant land. They called our property vacant land. When they said vacant land, I stood up. I said, that's a big lie. I'm not in court, you know, and there's a judge up there. I said, judge, that's a lie. This is not vacant land. This is our church property. That's our entranceway that they're going to take. He says, I understand, Reverend Jackson, but sit down, please, and our lawyer is pulling me down. He said, Reverend Jackson, I'm sorry, but I'm going to have to give this property to Sarasota County to build a road through your property. He said, but I would recommend that you sue Sarasota County. The judge said that. He said, they're not giving you sufficient money, and the county never, anyone that they took land from, they did not give them sufficient money. Everybody had to sue Sarasota County because they were dishonest. And so we sued Sarasota County. The lawsuit lasted for 3 years. You think that I didn't have anything better to do than to mess with Sarasota County and with lawyers every single day and with engineers and with land planners? You think that I didn't have anything else to do? I'm telling you, if you've ever been in a battle like this and a lawsuit like this, and you know what I'm talking about, it's an everyday thing. For 3 years, I'm with lawyers day after day, talking to lawyers, talking with people every single day. Here I am trying to do the work of the Lord, and I'm doing this. They never told me when I was in seminary I was going to have to be a lawyer. You know what? 3 years we went through this thing. We mounted a bill of $72,000. $72,000. I didn't have $72,000. But you know what? I knew that God was the winner. You know what? I knew that God would give us victory because we were in the right. Just like David was saying, why me? You know, there were many a day when I was having to call lawyers up and talk with these people and meet with these people and go downtown and meet with those people. But I was saying, why me? Man, I'd much rather be out winning souls to the Lord. I'd much rather be going to the hospital, doing my job, rather than having to do this work. Why do I have to do this? Why me? I've not done anything. I've done everything God's told me to do. Why am I having to do this, Lord? You've got a reason. I can't understand it, but I'm going to trust you. I'm going to rely upon you. And we did. For 3 years, this county finally settled with us, paid all of our debts, gave us money for the property, gave us the ability to be able to build another building on our church property, gave us all of the we don't have to have any more retention on our property, and we settled. It was over. And I think to myself, why did God want us to do that? But you know what? Since that time, I fought many a cases. You know what? That's part of the ministry, I'm afraid to tell you. It's part of the ministry, having to deal with lawyers. I'm having to call lawyers all the time, dealing with these things. I said, the Lord was just preparing me, amen? The Lord is getting me ready to have to deal with this stuff. I tell young preachers, and I tell college presidents, I said, one thing you need to teach your preacher boys, you need to give them some courses on law, because they're going to have to deal with it when they're in the ministry. God prepares us to deal with these things. God prepares us, and God was preparing David, and God prepares us. God allows these things to come into our life to prepare us, doesn't he? He prepares us. He protects us while we're going through it. David said, why me? Hear me, he said. Keep me. Show me. And then he said, deliver me. Look at verses 13 through 15. Deliver me. Arise, O Lord. Disappoint him. Cast him down. Deliver my soul from the wicked, which is thy sword, from men which are thy hand. O Lord, from men of the world which have their portion in this life, and whose belly thou fillest with thy hid treasure. They are full of children, and leave the rest of their substance to their babes. As for me, I will behold thy face in righteousness. I will be satisfied when I awake with thy likeness. He's talking about going to heaven. This is great. David says, deliver me from the men of this world. They enjoy the blessings of God. You see what he's saying there? Deliver me from those that are my enemies, that enjoy the blessings of God. He's talking about those people that enjoy the blessings of God, but they never thank God for it. You know what? God has given us this world. Amen? God has given us all these things. It's a wonderful. You go out today, you look and say, man, it's beautiful out there. Amen? It's a great day. David said, my enemies, those people, they enjoy these things. They never even tell you thank you for it. You made all things. They're not even grateful for what you've done. He said, I don't have much of this world now. He said, but I'm not even concerned about those things. I'm looking for the world to come. Amen. I'm looking for heaven. That's what he says in verse number 15. For as for me, I will behold thy face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake with thy likeness. The people of this world, they go after the things of this world and they think it's going to bring them happiness. But we know that the things of this world, they don't bring happiness. Amen? They don't. If you're one of those who think that the more you have of this world, the people think that the more they have this world, the more the happier they will be. My friend, you can have it all, but it's not going to make you happy. Amen. If you think that the more you get, a bigger house or better cars or better clothes or better job or more money, you think that's going to make you happy, my friend, you're mistaken. It's not going to make you happy. You say, how you get happy? I'll tell you how you get happy. Be content with what God's given to you, amen? Be satisfied with what God has given to you. You can be happy today, right this morning. I can tell you how to be happy. Be content, be satisfied with what God has given to you, and you'll be the happiest person in this place, amen? But if you think you've got to have one more thing, then my friend, you're not going to be happy. Amen? One more thing, not going to do it. You know, as a little kid, man, you'd get all those presents, all those things, and you'd keep opening, and you're never satisfied. end up playing with a box. David said, listen, this world, they got all this stuff, and they keep getting more, and then they don't even thank the Lord for it, and they're going to give everything they have to the children. That's what he says in that psalm. He said, they don't even thank you for it. They're not happy. Happiness comes when we're in the will of God and we're content and satisfied with what God has given to us. Then we can be happy. We can be happy. David says, deliver me from these people. Rich businessman saw one of his employees, and this fellow is just as happy as a lark whistling. And the rich man said to him, would you be happy if you had more money? He said, no, I'd be just as happy as I am right now. He said, but if you want to give me more money, I'll take it. You know what? We can be just as happy right now. If you would just be in God's will, get in God's will, and be content with what God has given to you, you can be happy. David was happy. He said, I'm looking forward to heaven. Amen. That's what I'm looking for. I can't wait to be in heaven with the Lord. That's what he's saying there when I'm in your likeness. He made these petitions. He said, help. Why me? Hear me. Keep me. Show me. Deliver me. Did God answer him? God answers several ways. God says, sometimes immediately he says yes. Sometimes he says to wait. Sometimes he says, my grace is sufficient for you. Rest in my grace. Trust my grace. You say, but why does it allow these things to happen? I can tell you this. One reason is for his glory. God is glorified when we are able to be sustained and continue to go on and not quit and not give up when the troubled times come. John chapter 11 and verse 4. The Bible says when Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. 2 Thessalonians 1, 4 and 5. So that we ourselves glory in you, in the churches of God, for your patience and faith, in all your persecutions and tribulations that ye endure. Then 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 10. But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, making you perfect, established, strengthened, settle you. It's for the glory of God. I can't tell you every reason. People come to me, they say, why is this going on? I can't tell you. People sometimes want me to explain it to them. Why am I going through this? I can't tell you why you're going through that, but I know this, if you'll continue and you won't quit and you won't give up, then you'll do it for the glory of God. Amen? Amen. God will be glorified by that. Just don't quit. A pastor and his family they were on vacation. They went up to Lake Michigan on vacation. While they were there, they were right on the shoreline, and while they were right on the shoreline, they had a sailboat. And every day they could go out sailing. And they loved that. And when I was a teenager, we used to go sailing. We had a sailboat and we used to go sailing. I enjoyed sailing. And it's been a few years since I did that, but I just enjoyed that. It's very relaxing to sail out there, the quietness, and it's just a wonderful feeling to go out. And every day, this pastor and his family, they would go out, get on this boat, and they would go out and sail on Lake Michigan. One day, they were out there sailing. They had gone a long way. And that's a big lake, Lake Michigan. I don't know if you've ever been there, but it's big. They'd gone a long way out there, and they were calmed. You know what that means? They were calm. There was no wind. Sometimes we call it becalmed, but they were calmed out there. There was no wind, and they were way out there. I mean, they couldn't see the shore. They were way out there. And that sailboat didn't have an auxiliary motor. Sometimes I'll tell you what, if I was sailing up there, I'd have an auxiliary motor. Even if I was sailing here, I would have an auxiliary motor on that thing, you know. And they didn't have one. They're way out there. He's got no motor on that thing, no auxiliary motor. And they were out there. He thought, surely the wind is going to pick up. There was no wind. And so he began to pray. Dear Lord, please send the wind. Please send just a little wind, Lord. You know how you pray? just a little wind would do. Just send me a little wind, Lord. There was no wind. They were becalmed. They were just sitting there. Time went on. A couple hours went on. They were calmed out there. No wind. And he's praying, Lord, just send some wind. Please, Lord. You know how you start panicking after a couple hours? You're praying, just send me any wind will do, dear Lord. Just a bird flapping its wings flying by. That would be okay. Send me something. Nothing. Nothing. Dead still out there. Way far away. All of a sudden he heard something. It sounded like a boat motor. And he looked, and sure enough, it was a boat coming right for them. It was a fisherman. He came right up to them. He said, "You need some help?" He said, "Sure." Threw him a line, and he grabbed the line, and that fisherman pulled him all the way back to shore. The pastor said he learned a valuable lesson that day. God didn't answer his petition and send a wind. God sent a fisherman with a motorboat. Amen. Listen, God doesn't always answer us the way we ask. Amen. But God will meet our need, won't he? God will meet our need, and God met the need of David, and God will meet our need. Next time you say, why me? God has an answer, amen? We need to trust in him. Let's bow our heads. Every head bowed, every eye closed. No one looking about. You say, preacher, that's what I've been praying. Why me? I've had some things that I've gone through, and I've been saying, why me? But I can understand now, and I'm going to trust the Lord. I know that's where I need to go. Would you pray for me today? I've been asking that same question, why me? God spoke in my heart here today. Would you pray for me today? Slip your hand up all through this building. Here's my hand. Pray for me today. I've been asking, why me? Here's my hand. Thank you. Amen. All through the building. Anyone else? Amen. Thank you. Amen. Thank you. Anyone else? Say, here's my hand. Thank you. Amen. I see your hand back there. Anyone else? Yes, sir. I see your hand up here. I see your hand down here. Anyone else? Say, include me in that prayer. I've said that. Why me? Yes, ma'am. I see your hand. Yes, ma'am. I see your hand. Yes, sir. I see your hand. Anyone else? Say, include me in that prayer. Yes, ma'am. Anyone else? Yes, I see your hand back there. Anyone else? Say, would you pray for me? Would you include me in that prayer when you pray? I've been asking, why me? I can see what God's word says. I can see what David did. And I'm going to pray for you, and I'm going to pray that you'll pray like David. We know where to go, don't we? We know what to do. We need to go to the Lord. When we come to those why me moments, we need to go to the Lord. The Lord can help us, and the Lord will help us get through. He'll provide for our need, just like he provided for that need of that pastor and his family when they were out there in that boat. God can provide for us. God can meet our needs, and God will meet our needs, but we need to trust him. We need to rely upon him. We need to go to him. Maybe there's someone you need to pray for. You say, I know some folks that are going through some struggles in their life, some difficult times, and I'm going to pray for them. Would you pray with me for them? Here's my hand. I'm going to pray for them. I know some people are going through some tough times. Would you pray with me? Thank you. Amen. Hands all through the building. All of us know somebody, don't we? They're going through some tough times. Yes, well, let's pray for them. We know what to do. We need to go to the Lord. Now, if you're not saved here today, you can expect troubles to come. You know why those troubles come? They come to bring you to Christ, so that you'll come to Christ. Today, you'd say, you know what? I need to come to Christ. I can understand why those troubles have come into my life, because God wants me to come to him. Could I pray for you right now? You say, I can see I need to come to Christ today. I'd like to know Christ. I'd like to know that I have eternal life. I'd like to know that for sure. Could I pray for you today? Would you slip your hand up, then put it back down? Could I pray for you? Say, I'd like to know that I'm on my way to heaven. I'd like to be sure I'm saved. Anyone? I'd like to know about that. I'm going to have a word of prayer in just a moment. We're going to pray. So many people raised their hands here today. So many have asked, why me? I'm going to pray for you today. Then we have many that raised their hand and said, I know someone who's going through some terrible times. We're going to pray for those people too. Let's stand to our feet with our heads bowed, and I'm going to pray. And then we'll have the invitation time. We'll invite you to come. We'll invite you to come to the altar here today and pray. Maybe you have a need this morning. You want to come to the Lord. That's what David did. He knew where to go. You know what? You need to know where to go. You need to come to the Lord. Dear Lord, be with this invitation time. Dear Lord, you know every person here. You know the difficulties that people are going through, the troubles that they're going through. And dear Lord, you're concerned about them. And we pray today, just as David prayed, we pray that you'd hear us today. Pray that you'd keep us. Dear Lord, we pray that you'd deliver us. Dear Lord, I pray for your help here today. Be with these dear folks. They're wondering what in the world's going on. You know, dear Lord, and you can help them and you can deliver them. And I pray that you would. I pray for your strength, your power, and your help, and your encouragement, and your grace, and your mercy. Dear Lord, show mercy today. Bless this invitation time. I pray that folks would come. Father, we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing, and as we sing, why don't you come right now? As we sing, why don't you come? We know where to go, don't we? To the Lord in prayer. Why don't you come? Go to the Lord in prayer. Why don't you come right now? As we begin to sing, you come.
Just as